Welcome to the Resilience Conversations, a portal into the world of inspiration and creative thinking about finding our inner strength and learning how to use it. I'm Rondi Charleston, and I'm so excited to share some practical, helpful, and in some cases, mind-boggling insight from some of today's most highly respected thinkers, leaders, and artists. I hope you'll join me in this fascinating series about learning and cultivating the essential qualities of resilience. Senator Booker, thank you so much for joining us. Welcome to the Resilience Conversations.
It is great to be here. Thank you for coming to my office.
We are not taking away from any Senate votes, are we?
No. You'll hear some annoying buzzing going that we have to run to the floor should that happen.
Okay, good. So I've been intrigued by this idea of resilience and the power of resilience for quite a while now. And it's, you know, all about our ability to bounce back and adapt after seriously difficult setbacks. You seem to epitomize the spirit of resilience. You speak truth to power. You don't back down, and you do it all with such passion and dignity. What drives you? What keeps you going?
Well, I think I've got in my life great models of resilience, whether it's the stories from my childhood of people under unimaginable challenges, unimaginable conditions. That my parents made me realize. My dad would look at me walking around the house and say, "Boy, don't you dare walk around this house like you hit a triple. You were born on third base. You have no idea the debt you owe to people under impossible odds who endured with indomitable wills, who overcame." And those stories of those folks from my family and from history really buoyed me to have that kind of attitude of resilience no matter what challenges I encountered. And then as I started working as a college student, as a law student in inner city communities from East Harlem to East Palo Alto, you would encounter these heroic people who loved their communities and were intent on making the American dream, the American spirit, wild and abundant in their communities as well. And then the final stage of people that inspire me to this day, and in my actual office here, I still have the picture of the community in which I still live. I'm the only United States senator who goes home to an inner city community that's low income, but it's a rich, wealthy community, wealth with the wealth of spirit. And I met the most amazing heroes for a while in this neighborhood. I live down the road now, but I lived in these high-rise, what became public housing projects. The tenant president of these buildings was a woman whose son was murdered in the lobby of the building in which I live.
Virginia Jones.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And she just taught me she fought and fought for those buildings. This elderly, you know, maybe 5 foot tall woman who once was taken to court by the much larger slumlord because she punched him in the face. Not that I support that kind of violence, but the judge sort of looked up and looked at her, looked at him, and threw the case out of court. But she's just was a fighter that showed me what resilience is all about. And her vision, she's passed away now, for her community, now that we have new parks and new schools, really has come to light, and we are experiencing that today. We're seeing that today because she saw it then. When others couldn't see it, she saw it, fought for it, worked for it, laid the foundation for what is now the truth.
So let's talk a bit about the resilience of us as a country. With our current administration and president, it feels like the gulf between red and blue is widening, not narrowing. And not to dwell in despair, but it feels almost like we're irreparably broken. Can you just illuminate this for us and tell us, you know, you're on the inside. Are we? Are we broken?
No, we're not. We're not a society that's broken. And we can't have historical amnesia to the fact that there's been tougher times in American history. And I'm not talking centuries ago. I'm talking about the 1940s when we were a nation at war, had just been attacked by Pearl Harbor. I'm talking about the 1950s, where you saw lynchings going on in this nation. The 1960s, where you saw tough places like people literally getting beaten back in Alabama on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, people dying like Goodman, Cheney, Schwerner, Mississippi, a governor standing up saying segregation now, segregation forever. It seemed one could have indulged in despair then. The 1970s with the Vietnam War and the challenges we saw with the carnage going on, human carnage going on. There's so many times in history. And we've seen demagogues. We saw from Father Conklin to among the McCarthy era, where our government systems were being twisted to be used against innocent people who were being blacklisted. I can go through all the tough times in our history. The truth of America, the light of America, often becomes most luminescent during our darkest periods of time, when people do not forget who they are, who commit themselves to the ideals of this country. It's that resolute poem by Langston Hughes who says, America never was America to me, and yet I swear this oath, America will be. And so now for those of us that are seeing things that violate our collective values and principles, this is the time. You are never defined in life by what happens to you. Where you have your power and where you define your essence is how you respond to what happens to you in life. And so this is one of those moments where we're going to define ourselves, not by what's happening on the news day after day, but how we as individuals and then in the collective choose to respond to that. And so do we respond to darkness with darkness? Do we respond to hate with hate? Or do we choose light and do we choose love? And I'll give you an example. I said this to an audience once and it looked like they were shocked when I said how this has been one of my favorite years as an American citizen this last year.
Really? And
absolutely, because wow. During the darkest moments when I was even indulging in the darkness, when I stood on that stage right behind the president when he gave his American Carnage speech, and I studied the great inaugural addresses of the past with malice towards none and charity towards all, then I hear the speech with a whole lot of malice, very little charity. I went home that night with a throbbing headache, curled up in bed, but then I woke up the next morning. Hundreds of thousands of women all across the country came out with a sign of hope, defining the truth about hope, that hope is not a magical feeling that you get. Hope is a conviction that despair will never have the last word. And that day, those 48 hours, the last word wasn't the inauguration in that speech, the last word was the chorus of conviction from hundreds of thousands of women. Just weeks later, I see an ugly Muslim ban being put forth by the president that shook my heart and my spirit. But then I get called out to the Dulles airport and I run out there to try to negotiate the people that were being detained so to get lawyers. And I go into that lobby and I see hundreds of Americans cheering Muslims, some of them not even American citizens, coming out of the gate, cheering them. I saw people with yarmulkes and tzitzas cheering Muslim families. That was the America. That's what America looks like. And that's what's been happening this entire year. With every action, people have chosen what their reaction is, not to give in or to give up, but to stand up and to speak up. This has been a time where I've seen people, thousands coming to the Capitol saying, we will not let you take away our health care or take us back to a time in America where a pre-existing condition could stop you from having health care, and pre-existing conditions sometimes were just being a woman. And so this has been a year of difficult, hard, painful, frightening things. But the thing that has continued to lift me is the determination, that indomitable will again, the indefatigable spirit of Americans who constantly are saying, this is not who we are. I am going to take responsibility, because every day you have a choice to accept things as they are or take responsibility for changing them. And this has been a year where I've seen millions of Americans stand up and do things to be the change.
The energy of the Me Too movement and all the
absolutely
grassroots movements have
been incredible.
So maybe the government is broken, but the American people aren't.
Well, I would even say more than that. We are the government. And a lot of times we don't realize that the opposite of justice is not injustice, it's apathy, it's indifference, it's inaction. And so we have a lot of folks that need to say that the reason why things are tough right now is not because, don't blame it on a person, Donald Trump, but because tens of thousands of people in Pennsylvania, in Michigan, in Wisconsin didn't come out and vote. They didn't see it important enough to come out and vote. It is always going to be, the biggest threat is always going to be apathy and indifference and ignorance of what's really going on. And King said it more eloquently than I could. He said, what we'll have to repent for in this day and age is not just the vitriolic words and violent actions of the bad people, but the appalling silence and inaction of the good people. And so perhaps this is a time of civic resurgence, of civic renewal, where we suddenly see that this democracy we've inherited, every generation has to pay for our freedom, fight for our rights, and get engaged. And so when I go around and saw what I saw in Alabama, what I saw in Virginia, whether it's Virginia electing a transgender woman who was running against one of the most homophobic people, and she wasn't running with her biggest issue, transgender rights. Her biggest issue was just making the traffic work in her neighborhood. Right. When I campaigned in Alabama.
And she won.
And I campaigned next to Doug Jones in Alabama, and every campaign stop, he wasn't talking about the perversions of his opponent. He was talking about health care. He was talking about jobs.
Exactly.
And so you define yourself by not what you're against. You define yourself by what you're for. And this has been a time for me of great hopefulness. And that has been, I'd like to say I've generated it all myself, but this country, no matter how bad things get, never fails to inspire me with the spirit of this nation and the love, kindness, and decency of Americans.
When are you going to run for president?
I might talk to you about running from the president right now.